Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of COVID Conversations. Today we have with us Mr. Harsh Mandal, who is a human rights activist, he's a columnist, and he's also a researcher who works with the underprivileged in the country. He's recently written a book called Locking Down the Poor, based on the migrant crisis last year because of the lockdown, and he even called it a crime against humanity. Now we had just started to sort of truly understand the massive economic after effects of the lockdown last year. And now, unfortunately, we've been hit once again. So I really want to thank Mr. Mandal for joining us on this episode to explain the impact of the lockdown, especially for the underprivileged, and what we can expect in the coming months because of it. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
My pleasure.
I want to start with the lockdowns which have been imposed in several states this time around. I am in Kolkata, like I told you, and the state is under a complete lockdown. Now, I think we all understand some of the adverse economic impacts of a lockdown, especially on the poor or on small business owners, or even for those in the unorganized and even to some extent in the organized sector. But this time around, to tackle this massive health infrastructure crisis that we're seeing in the second wave, many health experts also called for a complete lockdown to break the chain of transmission. Now, of course, the exodus of migrants is happening again, but this time it's not grabbing as many eyeballs because, like I said, lockdown is considered the need of the hour. How do you look at this? And do you think the lockdown this time around was necessary? And or do you think it could have been avoided completely with better preparedness?
Let me start with the idea of the lockdown in itself. When the Prime Minister announced the first lockdown, all of us will remember that speech. And he told us, stay at home, work from home, keep social distance, wash your hands. While he was speaking, I was thinking, you know, it's incredible that he's our prime minister, but he is, you know, he seems to have forgotten that the large proportion of our population, 9 out of 10 workers are, for instance, informal workers. So they won't, you know, they won't get a salary if they stay at home. There's no possibility of working from home. So what's going to happen to them, you know? Secondly, he said, stay at home. So firstly, you have to have a home where you can stay. What about homeless people or people who live under, you know, plastics and so on and so forth? He said, keep social distance. Now, if 10 people are living inside one shanty and 100, 150 people are sharing one community toilet, there's no possibility of any kind of distancing. And water, wash your hands regularly. You have to have access to running water, and large populations do not. So I think what we need to understand is that even in design, in its best implementation, a lockdown offers no protection to the large mass of the working poor. It seems to be giving some protection to people like you and me who have homes, who have formal jobs where we get paid, where we have running water and so on. But it does not. It excluded even in design the very poor. Lockdowns, even in design, exclude the large mass of the laboring poor, but it places the highest burdens of economic suffering on those who it is not protecting. And I think that we need to understand that. And how India's lockdown, in decision to have a lockdown last year, was the largest shutdown of the economy on the planet in human history. We need to understand, you suddenly overnight close all demand and all supply. We have starved the public health system for decades. Or we are one of the lowest investments, less just a little over 1% of GDP is spent on public health. On healthcare. And a minimum is supposed to be about 3%, preferably higher. We are a country where double of that amount is spent from out of pocket for private spending. So instead of investing in the public health system, we have, by public policy, encouraged for-profit private hospitals, which seem to provide great care for people who could afford those. But even in design, again, they excluded the poor. But once the COVID crisis has hit us, we've seen that the private 80% of India's doctors work for the for-profit private sector, 80%. Just 20% work for the public sector. Now, that private healthcare system, even the most generous estimates say that they do not provide more than, contribute more than about 10% to the COVID response. So 20% of trained health personnel in a completely starved public health system and broken public health system had to provide 90% of the care. The 10% care provided by public private hospitals, it was shamefully overpriced and exploitative in open ways.
Yeah.
And that continued to be, you know, the state, the government did not, has done nothing to regulate them. And right through it, I wrote a piece recently saying that the government seems, even today, in the middle of all of this crisis, whether it's hospital beds, whether it's oxygen production and transportation, whether it's vaccines, they seem more interested in protecting private profit rather than the public good.
Also, in the first lockdown, you did not prepare for the first wave, which it was intended, which you intended to do. You did not prepare for the first wave, and you certainly did not prepare for this wave that we are seeing right now.
So I'm saying that even the first lockdown had these problems, had huge problems. Now, the Prime Minister announced we have created 1 lakh COVID beds. Now, our Prime Minister is often, to say, put it politely, is often very economical with the truth. New beds were not created. Beds were repurposed. So you took away cancer beds, you took away other beds. I mean, in Bombay, you had this dramatic example of cancer patients being made to lie under an overbed on mats because those beds were redeployed for COVID. You didn't create a new infrastructure. You could have created a new infrastructure as a massive plan, but you had to create beds which are, you could have taken over stadiums, colleges, schools. The infrastructure was available, but you needed health personnel. And as I said, the health personnel, we were allowed to go completely, almost, 80% into the private healthcare system. And I strongly believe that the only way we could have actually created this new infrastructure would have been to nationalize the private healthcare system for the period of the health emergency. And countries like Spain have done that. So every trained medical worker in the country becomes a public servant for the period of this emergency. And they are allotted to tasks based on an actual need and during the period. But there was no question of doing any of that. So what did we have as an outcome? And that's why I called it a crime against humanity. India had the harshest lockdown with the smallest relief package and the most privatized healthcare system, which it did very little to remedy. Even China, I mean, we can compare ourselves with, say, China and Pakistan. These are the two countries we're often hyphenated with. China, at its peak, locked down 5% of its population. We locked down 100% of our population. It just did not make sense. And we did it completely mindlessly, thoughtlessly. And relief packages we're seeing around the world were much larger, even in market capitalist economies, did a great deal more to protect people through this period. The second wave actually is what we're seeing now is even more troubling, because if anything, at least you had 1.25 years, you could have built a health infrastructure, you could have built oxygen. It requires a simple, you know, a school child would be able to do a calculation that this is our population, these are the number of vaccines we require, this is what we are able to produce, what more do we need to produce, where will we get it from, you know, what Prime Minister Modi, former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh wrote, was simply that you should have open license and encourage, you know, manufacturers across the country to produce vaccines way back from, you know, last year. We should have prepared as soon as the formula was available. People would have, if India had actually gone in for large scale vaccination, we've seen the US. The US is under Biden has actually now talking about restoring normalcy, even to the extent that you don't wear masks. And that's largely.
And I think they have five vaccines for every citizen. They have five vaccines per citizen.
Yeah. And because they succeeded in the vaccination, it has to go into, it has to be done like the election mode. I've been an administrator. Every election booth needs to, you know, can become the unit. And we've done it in pulse polio and so on and so forth. It needed to be planned in that kind of way. So we neither planned oxygen, we didn't plan hospital beds, we didn't plan vaccinations, we didn't plan ambulances. We were celebrating how great our response was. We had election rallies where the topmost leaders didn't bother to wear masks. We
all sorts of things. We had religious congregations. We had
everything. That was supposed to be next year. It was brought forward amazingly to this year.
Yeah.
And it is the largest, it's going to be the largest super spreading event, I think, in the world. So what I think our viewers need to understand is that we're seeing a massive explosion of deaths, but these deaths, please don't think that these deaths are caused by the virus. Most of the deaths are caused by state failures. When your gas, oxygen, when you can't get a hospital bed, when they tested you, when you're getting black fungus infections because of, excessive steroids being given, pumped into you, when there's black marketing for everything, and of course after death with funerals and so on and so forth. These are state failures, spectacular state failures, which have caused very clearly tens of thousands of deaths have been caused by acts of omission and commission by the state, and they are directly responsible.
I completely agree with you. You know, sir, I have been covering the Bengal elections in the state from January to May this year, and I witnessed the impact of the first lockdown. On the poor, the less privileged, those people who were involved in small industries, transport laborers, fish sellers, idol makers, artisans, they were all just pushed to extreme poverty. And things had just started to somewhat pick up in terms of their income. And then now, of course, this has happened. I shudder to think about the combined effects of these lockdowns. I do want to understand from you, what are the short-term and the long-term effects of this lockdown on the poor, according to your research?
See, we are seeing the largest contraction of the economy since independence. Official estimates are probably grossly underestimating the extent to which the economy is contracted. Now, even sort of very optimistic, we'll go back to the pre-lockdown position maybe in 2 or 3 years. Now, what does that mean in concrete terms? It means that jobs will shrink, demand will shrink, money to be spent will shrink. massively. We are slipping into a depression, into a recession. And see, people are slipping into poverty from which it is going to be harder and harder for them to emerge. That's what we need to understand. When job possibilities are shrinking and you are being pushed down, when demand, also you need to understand that when people will not have money to spend in local markets. I mean, we've done a recent hunger survey, we published a report. So 2/3 of the people said that they had started eating less.
Yeah.
Many of them sleeping hungry. The quality of food, you know, egg, meat, dal, those had and leafy vegetables, etc., had gone down substantially. Now, when people will not have money to spend, the economy will, you know, and that's why this measure of if they had done cash transfers universally, it would have not only been compassionate public policy, it would have also been, you know, hard economics, because demand would not have, you know, you need to understand simple economics is demand and supply. I mean, people have to have money to be able to buy, and then there has to be the production capacity. You shut down overnight all demand and all supply. And that point that I wanted to underline is that compassionate economic policy was also sound economics from a very hard utilitarian perspective. The economy would have actually not gone into this kind of recession if we had done the basic transfers that we did, and which capitalist industrialized countries have done on a much larger scale.
Yeah, so last year when the lockdown was announced in March, now that time we had less than 1,000 cases in the country. This time around, the lockdown doesn't seem as senseless because firstly, there isn't a national lockdown. It is, like you said, it is imposed in states and districts where numbers are high. Will that make a difference?
No, I think in effect, actually, I was reading somewhere that more than 90% of the country is locked down. But these lockdowns are at least, you know, public transport between, you know, trains and so on are still functioning. Buses are still functioning.
Yeah.
Some sort of minimal economic activity is still happening.
Yeah, you have markets open in the morning for 2 hours and then in the evening for two hours. Yeah.
But what we required was, you know, we certainly needed restrictions. So the restrictions should have been on, firstly, on election rallies. There should have been restrictions on large religious gatherings for people of every faith, on marriages, on large gatherings. Those kinds of restrictions make sense, and they continue to make sense. You need to contain areas, you need to have stronger isolation facilities.
Yeah.
Now, I'm just at kind of measures, again, working with the homeless, the Delhi government announced that we have a policy that of home isolation. So they shut down a lot of the facilities.
Yeah.
And home quarantine. So my question to them was that, what about people who don't have homes? And what about people who have homes are too small for them to either quarantine or isolate? And they're the larger population of this country. You've just forgotten about them. Now, the idea that, you know, which we've been comfortable with in this country is that the government works for the rich and the middle classes. And we are protected. Our healthcare is protected. We get great schools, education, everything else. And we don't care what happens to the working poor. I think the big thing we have to learn, even from a completely selfish point of view, is that you're not safe until every single person in this country is safe. And therefore, you know, this illusion that we are banging thalis and lighting candles, and, you know, while we were doing it, migrants in millions were walking the streets and seemed to care. We were celebrating because we felt hum to bache hue hain. बचे हुए नहीं थे बिकॉज द वायरस डजंट सॉर्ट ऑफ डिस्टिंग्विश बिटवीन रिच एंड पुअर
डेफिनेटली You know, there is a general consensus that till the time the whole population, like we were just discussing, till the time the whole population is vaccinated, there will always be a possibility of a third, fourth, fifth wave of the virus. But the dependence on technology, you know, to conduct the vaccination drive, or even seek healthcare for that matter, because we've seen most of the response for SOS, we've seen that on social media. Now, there's such a massive, divide in this access to technology between the urban and rural India. Do you think that the digital dependence is also proving to be a big deterrent for the poor to get healthcare in this country?
Yeah, you know, I think that it continuously blind. I mean, when with great reluctance they started the migrant trains last year, after huge suffering, they wanted them to, you know, get a health certificate from a doctor. They wanted to apply, online, digitally, etc., etc. I mean, don't you know that these are starving migrants who, you and I would at that time have found it difficult to get a health certificate from a doctor in the middle of the lockdown. Right. How would the migrants get it? How would they, and many of them don't have smartphones. If they had, they would have sold them. How do they, apply online, etc.? And yet when the flights started, and they had to quarantine at the other end. When the flight started, no health certificate was required, no quarantine. Mm-hmm. And when the aviation minister was asked why, he said, no, it's not practical. So it's not practical for, well-networked people like us who can afford flights, but it is practical for the poorest. Likewise, now in terms of the vaccine, how you have to sort of get registered online, et cetera, is so complicated. How are you expecting the poor to do this? Yeah. Above 45, I mean, I can bring you any number of homeless people who are, there's no question of anyone reaching out to them. Effectively now, we are the only country in the world where you'll have to pay for your vaccines. And private hospitals are free to charge any rate they want, unregulated by the state. And what this means is that those of us who have money will break the line, be able to break the line, go into a private hospital and get our vaccinations. The working poor will neither have the networks nor the money to spend on, to spend 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees per vaccination for everyone in your family. It amounts to a fair amount of money and the confidence to walk into Max or Polo to get this done. What is the government trying to do? And in this, we are shamefully the only country in the world which doesn't have free vaccinations.
Yeah. You
imagine if we were trying to eliminate polio and we said everyone has to pay 5 rupees or 10 rupees for polio drops, just that amount. Would we have succeeded?
Hmm. Yeah. So you filed a petition in the Supreme Court about 2 weeks ago for, to ensure food and cash transfer of minimum wages for all migrant workers, at least for the time period that economic activity will be affected. Now that, of course, has not been enforced. Now, last year we saw dry rations were provided by the center and the state governments, but cash transfers, they happened very sporadically and very, very unequally.
And very small amounts. Even the little cash transfer they had was about 500 rupees, which is, about one and a half days of minimum wages. For some people. And so we've calculated 7,000 rupees for a family of five, just at average minimum wages. So we were saying that 7,000 rupees per household across the country universally to be distributed. It would have been, of course, a very complex logistical exercise. And that is again because we have not created a system. In rural areas, because of NREGA, you have a list of workers. In urban areas, we have virtually no list. I mean, if the state had not even got a, it has no sense of the numbers, it doesn't have the names, how many migrants are there? It's because you don't want to extend any protections. Once they are in your record, you have, you're responsible for them.
So I do want to talk to you about your own harrowing experience with COVID-19. I read that you were admitted in October last year in the All India Institute of Medical Sciences with COVID, and you called the experience as close to hell as possible is what you called it. Can you tell us what happened if you're comfortable with it?
Because my work and my heart is very closely linked with people in the margins, I felt there was no option except to be on the streets almost from the second day after the lockdown. I had expected to catch COVID much earlier, but I did not. And my doctors tell me that actually I was probably with the safest population because the destitute poor are not in contact with the middle class and the rich. And the rich and the middle class who brought in the... So our domestic helpers caught it from us, but the destitute poor were protected. And so as it happened, the first 6 months or so, I didn't catch COVID. Then we found after the opening up that that signs of COVID started among the homeless. But there was no thing, there were no services. So we decided to open a COVID clinic ourselves and with MSF, Medical Science Frontiers. And we found very high positivity rates and we did drills, et cetera. Now, because my colleagues were there, I also felt I should stand with them. And I think we all caught COVID from the COVID care centers. My whole family caught it from me, and I was in a bit of a dilemma. I have a bit of a heart problem, and I didn't want to put my family into trouble. So I agreed to the suggestion of going into a hospital, but I said it would have to be a public hospital. Not to use my prestige, I should go into a general ward. It was a decision that that proved very expensive to me, because when I went into the AIIMS general ward, I had imagined it was much worse than anything. It's supposed to be the premier hospital of this country. There were about 50 beds. It was pretty chaotic. I went in and I said, you expect to be given a set of clothes. They said, no, just lie down. We don't have any clothes. The monitor was supposed to be connected to me, but they said the monitor is not working. So at home, at least somebody was testing my oxygen every 2 hours or 3 hours. Here, there was no one testing me for anything. No one came to speak to me. No doctor saw me through that entire period. I started speaking to the ward boys, for instance. I discovered that all of them were untrained. The regular ward boys, the trained staff were not willing to come. The doctors were not coming to supervise. It was completely chaotic. The noise was extreme. And if anything had to happen to me, there was nothing. And this is the premier hospital of the country. Around 2 days later, I wanted to have a bath. I said, at least let me have a bath. You're not giving me a set of clothes or anything. And then something happened, and it's a mystery, but I lost my memory for 10 days. I had total amnesia. I stopped speaking. I stopped calling my wife. And everyone got worried, and they said, they couldn't understand what had happened to me. But the hospital staff said he's completely okay. So finally, my wife said, if he's completely okay, then why don't you discharge him? They said, by all means, just take him. And that's what I think saved my life. I went home. Apparently, I couldn't even recognize my wife and daughter. And I was asked who they were. I said they were nurses. And then after some days, my forehead started turning blue. And my family realized that this must be serious. So they took me to another hospital. And they said, it's nothing to do with COVID, but his brain is badly damaged. And it's a total mystery because the MRIs that they did, when doctors see it now, they say it's a miracle you're alive. My brain was sort of pushed forward and badly damaged. The Ames Hospital didn't even test me for anything, claimed that I was completely okay. My bleeding was so much that if I stayed on there for maybe about a week, I would have definitely died.
They didn't even diagnose that.
They didn't do it.
Was it COVID-induced or was it?
That's a mystery. That's a mystery some doctors say it could have been some COVID impact, but most doctors say that it was not. And that's what makes it more mysterious. This small experience for somebody who comes from a very privileged and network background, if this is what happened to me. And of course, now after phase two, many people have seen, but I saw how broken our public health system was and how uncaring, how unprepared, how unresponsive it was. So the private healthcare system and its abandonment of the poor, one can understand. But the public health system also, I think, has been starved and broken, but also was hesitant and negligent in its treatment of the poor.
So thank you so much for sharing your story and sharing your experience. And thank you so much for coming on the show and speaking about the lockdown and everything that you have learned in your experience in the last 1 year and in your research and in your groundwork. Can you at the end just explain the kind of work for the benefit of our viewers, explain the work that you've been doing with the homeless in the past one year since COVID?
Okay. So I'll be very careful not to call it charity work but solidarity work. I mean, it is really like all of us would try to help our family and our friends and our colleagues. It was a duty we owed in a situation where the state seemed to have abandoned them completely. So initially, of course, the number of cases were low and our concentration was on food distribution in Delhi and then in many parts of the country. And people started sending money from all over the world. We had not set out to do relief at that scale, but in the end, we distributed something like 10 million meals across the country during that first phase. The second phase, our relief is far more challenging because the economic crisis is, if anything, more chronic and deeper. Mm. And how do we respond to the health crisis? And so what we're trying to do, and of course, money is much smaller, but what we're trying to do is learning from the oxygen langars, which are great examples. Simple ambulances. Now, ambulances are quite expensive, but people have done jugaad, as they do in India, as to be getting auto ambulances,
right,
equipped with oxygen, helping people in funerals. Is another trying to link up referrals for people, large scale mass distribution. These are some of the things that we're trying to do. It's smaller than a drop in the ocean, but I think that is what we owe at the very minimum. But my ambition
can people
is
reach
to,
out? Can people reach out for help? Because that way, then I can.
Absolutely.
Give the details in the description.
I'll send you something. I mean, Karwane Mohabbat is basically the broad platform. It's not an organization, but it set out for in the context of hate lynching, but basically reaching out to people who are most vulnerable with respect and dignity and love is what we try to do.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for being a part of this episode and talking to us here on COVID Conversations. Thanks a lot.
It's a pleasure. And be safe.
Yes, sir. You too. Please take care of yourself. Thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, don't forget to virtually like it as well. Share the video and also subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon so you get updated every time we upload a new video. If you have suggestions for people you want to hear from, people you want to see on this channel, leave those suggestions in the comments below. You can get in touch with me on my social media handles. The details of all of that is there in the description. Now, if you're interested in paid promotions with this channel, we would be interested if you are a business or a brand without political affiliations. The details for how to get in touch with us for paid promotions is also there in the description below. In the meantime, take care of yourself, take care of your families, mask up, and do not leave your home until it is absolutely necessary. Take care of yourselves. Thank you so much for watching once again.